Hello and welcome to Got Clutter, Get Organized, a conversation. I'm just so excited because my feet over here are just going because I have a returning guest and friend and fellow organizer, Christy Lingo. Christy, I'm so excited to see you today.
Talk to you, Janet. I think this is like our third or fourth time chatting. I don't know.
I know. It's more than that. I think it's more than that. But today, because we are starting that back to school season, Christy's here really to help your parents, your moms, really kind of specifically if you are dealing with ADHD and just how to manage that and everything that's coming at you right now between the supply list and the uniform list, the activities list and all of that stuff. So that's why I wanted to bring Christy back. Christy, thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah. I have all those things. I am organized, but I also have children and I have ADHD. So I have a lot of experience with all of these things.
So for listeners who may not understand, well, I know you made the transition because you used to really focus on the organizing and you still do that, but you really transition to help people with ADHD better manage their lives. So what made you decide to really focus on that? But also, can you just give us a little bit better understanding ADHD and hyperactivity?
Yeah. Well, it's funny that you ask why I changed. Because ADHD, probably. Because ADHD people get bored after they've been doing something. And I had been doing professional organizing for 10 years. And it was kind of the perfect storm where I was kind of feeling a little trapped and a little stuck. And again, probably because of ADHD, and we don't know how to do things subtly. We just know how to blow things up and start over again, I feel like sometimes. And so rather than kind of pivot the organizing business, which was kind of, I loved still, and I loved the aspect of helping people. I'd had a lot of questions from other moms who had started businesses and they wanted to know how to juggle everything. And as I started to build this coaching business in 2019, I started to notice that a lot of those moms also had ADHD, which was something that I have a son with ADHD. I have ADHD. Many of my organizing clients had ADHD, which is actually what kind of brought it to my attention way back in 2009, 2010, because I didn't want to do a disservice to my organizing clients because I don't know from your experience, but working with somebody with ADHD, their brains operate a little bit differently. I'm not sure if you or your listeners are familiar with the terms neurotypical, which is what a lot of people would say normal, and neurodivergent, which is a spectrum of people. It can be people on the autism spectrum. It can be ADHD. It can be considered obsessive compulsive disorder, but it's anyone whose brain kind of operates outside of what we as a society have deemed typical. You just have to approach things a little bit differently. The advice that I would give to a neurotypical coaching or organizing client may be very different than the support and the advice that I would give to somebody with ADHD, because with ADHD specifically, it's all about executive function. And so you said, explain ADHD really briefly. What it is the prefrontal cortex in the front of your brain is the part of your brain that controls what's called executive function. So these are the things that we have to do when we want to focus, we want to concentrate, we want to solve a problem, we want to organize something, we want to control an impulse or something like that. With those of us with ADHD, we have a twofold problem. First of all, our prefrontal cortex tends to be smaller. And the second thing is, we have a dysregulation of the uptake of dopamine in our system. So this is where attention deficit hyperactivity disorder is a little bit of a misnomer, because it's not that we have an attention deficit. It's that the dopamine that we need to power our attention and other executive functions isn't necessarily uptaking the same way that it does for a neurotypical person. So we may want to concentrate on something and we're not able to kind of get the car started. It's like a cold winter morning and it just keeps turning over, but nothing's happening, right? There's other times when we can't stop ourselves from paying attention. We have a hyper focus where we spend 19 hours reorganizing our silverware drawer in our kitchen. So, I feel like over the next couple of decades, what we're really going to see is a shift in sort of the naming around what ADHD is, now that neuroscience is kind of giving us a little bit more in the details about how it presents. It's not something that you're choosing. It's that literally, if you looked at a neurotypical brain and an ADHD brain under a scan, they would operate completely differently. And so I feel like the more that we are able to learn about and accept that as a society, the more we're able to create like specific catered solutions and strategies for people that are neurodivergent.
And I agree with you, because I have a client I see once a month, and I really have to keep her focused. I can't give her too many things. It's like, we're going to do this. And then once that's finished, we're going to do this, because if I start saying we're going to do this, it gets her overwhelmed and she shuts down. So thank you so much for sharing that.
And when it, you know, to our topic today, in terms of kids, like if you happen to have an ADHD child, which if you're listening to this because you are a mother with ADHD, the chances of one of your children, if you have more than one, being ADHD is pretty good, because they have determined that it is genetic. And so, for instance, for my kids, I used to tell my poor son, like, okay, like, finish eating your breakfast, go get dressed, get your shoes on, brush your teeth, grab your bag. And he just was like, bleh, like completely shuts down, like can't figure it out. And it's to your exact point there, where it's like, we can hold on to one, maybe two instructions at a time. But that's where things like checklists are so handy for those of us with ADHD, because if it's something that you're doing repetitively, rather than telling somebody verbally, they can look at that checklist and say, oh, it eat breakfast, get dressed, put on shoes, brush teeth, grab bag, you know, so on and so forth.
So what are some of the challenges for people who may not know what exactly is going on for that back to school, and they're feeling so overwhelmed, specifically parents? And they're like, wait a minute, we go through this every single year. So what are some of the challenges when, one, the parent may have ADHD, but then also you're dealing with the child as well?
Yeah. Well, again, that overwhelm. And so what happens with ADHD when we start to feel overwhelmed, when we have too much input coming in, because input regulation is another executive function. And so we can be very overstimulated or over informationed very quickly. And what happens then is that we go into sort of a paralysis, where even though we know we need to get school supplies, or we know we need to buy school clothes or uniforms, or, you know, sign up for some, you know, our busing routes or whatever, we freeze and we can't work anymore. So some ways that you can kind of get around that, if you're feeling very overwhelmed, is to don't look at the big tasks as a whole, try to break them down. So for instance, rather than being like, oh, I have to buy all these school supplies and school clothes, and I have to do this, I have to, I'll be like, okay, so today I'm just going to focus on school supplies. And, you know, what's nice is that a lot of states here in the United States have tax holidays. And so when you're done listening to this episode today, find out if your state has a tax holiday and put it on your calendar that you're going to buy your school supplies that day, you know. And then what's another thing? Well, shopping. Let's say you have more than one kid. You don't have to take them all out one day, all day long, to go school shopping. Maybe just do one kid per day. But the ADHD brain is going to feel a lot more overwhelmed if it feels 1,000 things coming at it at once. But if you can isolate it and break it down into something small, and if it's like, if buying school supplies on one day feels very overwhelming, then be like, you know what, I'm going to just focus on the first 5 things on the list today. And then tomorrow I'm going to put the next 5 things in my cart. And the next day I'm going to put, because the important thing is that it gets done, not that it is done a certain way or to a certain perfection, which is a trap that many of us with ADHD fall into. Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it's one of the things you said, it was like a light bulb went off when you said, take one child at a time.
Yeah.
Because sometimes taking, like, especially if you got more, you know, you got 2, 3 and you're trying to get the school supplies, or maybe you're trying to get the new shoes, sneakers, and, you know, one child is, you know, sitting because they're getting fitted. The other two are maybe over there, and who knows, they may be just kind of tussling with each other.
They're hiding in the middle of the rack in the store.
And that can be overwhelming just for just anyone. But then when you are like dealing with all of these other things. So, and that was a really good tip. And then I also like what you said, just doing a little bit at a time, because I think, and I don't know because I've never had that experience, but I can only imagine having all of those lists. And then when you have all of those children, and one woman shared with me, because she's got, I got to take a moment to count, Christy. She had she's got six children.
That's a lot.
Six. They're all basically grown now. But what she had to do was because of parent-teacher night, and there was always conflicts. And she said, I had to basically talk to people and say, look, I can't be two places at once.
Right.
And you make some arrangements. So you are right. It's like just really figuring out what works for you.
Right.
So
there's no right or wrong way as long as it gets done. Like if you order all your school supplies from Amazon, or you go and you individually pick out your favorite folders at a, you know, an office supply store, you know, I think sometimes we have this idealized version of motherhood that, you know, we see Pinterest or we see Instagram and we think, oh, well, their kids are doing this, this, and this. And I think that in the last couple of years, one thing that we've really started to notice is people are trying to be a little bit more authentic. Like it's not this perfect thing all the time, because it can be stressful, and it can be especially stressful for those of us with ADHD because we're trying so hard just to keep things together on a daily basis. Then you compile it with this, you know, all these other activities that we need to do to get ready for school, plus this idea that it needs to be perfect, plus we have to have this, you know, summer bucket list that we finish up. You know, there's a lot going on and it can be very overwhelming. So really break things down, let go that it has to be a certain way. It's better to make sure that your kid is, you know, has what he needs and or she needs and gets off to school that day than it is that it has to be done a certain way, or they have to look a certain way, or they have to have a certain thing.
So as you were talking, I just, do you suggest specific tools for your clients? Because I know sometimes, you know, some of my clients are very visual. Mm-hmm. So therefore, I have to create systems that are visual so they can still maintain them but be organized. So are there specific tools that could help, you know, a parent during this time of year when they're just like, okay, I got all this paper and all these checks and to-do lists and everything?
Yeah, so the number one tool that I have found as a parent that works for my family is the checklist. So we create checklists ourselves. So I have like one is an out the door for school. So it's got all the different things that we need when we leave for school. And I even have shoes, coat, things that you think would be real obvious. There are so many times when we get in the car in the winter before I made these checklists and my ADHD kid would be like not wearing a coat on a 30 degree day. And he's like, I forgot to put it on. So this is going to take all of that out. Both my kids know you do the checklist. We walk out the door. We've got checklists for soccer. We've got checklists for swimming. I even made a checklist. Now he doesn't have as many issues anymore, but like my younger guy, also the ADHD guy, would forget to change his underwear and change his socks. And so he has a checklist upstairs that's like, take off all of your clothes. And it seems very silly to some people that you would have to instruct on the most basic things, but that's what's helpful for ADHD, starting from a base level. Even if they look at it and they know that that's the first step, so they always skip to step number two, it doesn't matter, because it's not like he's going to put two pairs of underwear on, but it's just sort of like getting him in the idea of this is what the full task is. It's taking off all the clothes and putting on fresh underwear and putting on pants and putting on your socks and going through all those steps. And so you can do checklists. You can do it for chores. You can do it for what is their routine when they get home from school. And what it does is it gives them, your kids, some structure and some routine, which even without ADHD, structure and routine is incredibly important for kids. It's part of the reason why teachers are able to control their classrooms, because they have a structure and a flow and a routine that their kids are used to. And so what you're doing is sort of creating that same sort of thing that they're used to in a classroom at home.
So Christy, as a businesswoman, mom, wife, and also a mother with a child who has ADHD, how do you manage or how do you stay organized? Because I know a lot of people are using like different digital systems mm-hmm. to help the family manage calendars. Some people have physical calendars, but what are some strategies that you use?
So in terms of time management, we do have a family Google calendar that is on my husband's phone. My son, who is 13 now, just got his first phone a couple of weeks ago. So he has it on his, but any sort of practices, games, events, slumber parties, birthday parties, anything that's like that goes on that family calendar. And then I have it integrated with my business calendar. So let's say somebody goes and they're trying to book something on a Tuesday morning right now. It will go ahead and block my schedule out because I know that Tuesday mornings we have swim and dive practice right now or something like that. So that's how I sort of manage the family calendar. And I make sure that everything has notifications. I usually do a 1 hour before and a 10 minute before notification. So on the things that I have on my digital calendar so that I can kind of keep up with that. And then from a working standpoint, then what I do is I take the family calendar and then I actually have a handwritten calendar that I do for myself each week, which I know everyone's like, oh, this just sounds like way too much stuff when I tell them. But it's like, once you kind of get into the flow, it's not too bad, especially since so many of the things that go on to the family calendar are usually either one and done where it's like a birthday party or an event, or it's a practice where you go in and you create repeating reminders. So it's not like you're putting 15 different events in every single time. You're just sort of like creating repeating reminders. But that's kind of how we manage our time. From our household standpoint, because, you know, like I run two businesses and I have, you know, two kids that are very active. I have a kid that plays club soccer and a kid that swims club swimming. And that's last school year, we had one night a week the entire year where we did not have something. And most nights we had two things in the evening. So it's very busy around here. One of the ways I stay on top of my house is I keep things very minimal. Now, I wouldn't call myself a minimalist necessarily, but I really put some effort, and summer is a good time to do this, into getting rid of anything that is around the house that is taking up space that shouldn't be taking up space. So, you know, I just recently got rid of a bunch of workbooks that were from like early elementary school, because in my head I was like, oh, the kids will work on these in the summer. Well, they never did. And so finally I just like let it go, and I cleared up a whole space in my living room on a bookshelf, just getting rid of it. And now I have space to put, you know, a basket for gloves or, you know, something else you know, like that was part of the reason why I wanted to get these shelves cleared off was last winter. I just felt like I never had any place to put hats and gloves and, you know, umbrellas and things like that on this bookshelf. And so really trying to keep things to a minimum is going to be helpful, because the less you have, the less you have to put away, right?
So true, Christy, because when you were saying that, I was thinking how people would tell me I needed to buy the bulk of everything. I'm like, okay, it's just me here, but it's going to be a cost savings. And I said, I understand it. But then I had to realize I don't have the space, because I'm in it's just me, one bedroom. I don't have the space for all of that. And right. Once I finally said, you know what, I'm okay. I'm still saving money because I get, you know, the pack of six of paper towel. But I have space for that. When I had those huge, you know, bulk items, I was trying to figure out, where am I going to put stuff? So I like what you said, like just getting rid of stuff.
Yeah, keep it to a minimum.
And of course, Christy, I'm like you. I do have a digital calendar, and that really kind of helps me just know, okay, this is where you're supposed to be, what time. But I have a physical planner because I love my planner, because it just lets me write stuff and put things. But I like the one where you said an hour before. Because my calendar, I need an hour before. I mean, you know, I'm good at staying on top of everything, but that hour before can really make a difference, because then you can get yourself mentally ready, physically ready. Like, yeah, I've got this going on. I love it.
I'm a big. That's one of my things that I really encourage my ADHD coaching clients to do, is to set notifications and alarms, because transitions happen to be something that we are not necessarily good with. And I feel like in population in general, we have trouble transitioning. We're like, oh, we've watched six episodes of Bridgerton, but we only have one left. Like, I want to stay up and watch one more, right? We have trouble making that transition to go to bed, or, you know, this transition out of our hyper-focus if we've been focused on something for so long. And so what those reminders do, so I use my little Amazon digital assistant. I won't say her name because she's right here. But I all the time will be like, set a timer for a half hour, set a timer for 15 minutes. To kind of give me that, like you're saying, that, something is coming soon that I need to start preparing for that transition. And it can work for kids in the morning if they're eating breakfast and they have 10 more minutes to eat breakfast before you need them to go get dressed for school. Set an alarm and have it go off, because then it's not like, Why haven't you finished eating? Now you got to get dressed and you didn't eat anything. Like, how many times have I said that in my life? But now, 15 to 10 or 10 to 15 minutes before they need to be getting upstairs, they get a little warning that says, hey, you work on finishing up your breakfast because you have 10 to 15 minutes. And breakfasts have been eaten so much better now that we sort of have that notification, that warning, if you will.
And that just sounds like you're just really having a lot smoother morning routine, because the rushing and the stress and the overwhelm, and you're going out the door and you're carrying that energy with you. It really seems like it just is a nice little flow. And you're right. It's just about creating systems and, you know, processes and strategies. So,
And one thing that I will caution people, as you set in place your routines, your brain, especially if you have ADHD, is going to start to tell you, like, oh, you don't need to follow that checklist anymore. Or you don't need that routine in place. You're doing just fine without it. Don't listen, because it's lying to you, right? Because towards the end of the school year, we got a little lazy about doing our daily checklist. And within 2 weeks, I had to make 4 additional trips back and forth to the school, because one day my son forgot his saxophone. The other day, my other son forgot his violin. And then both of them forgot their lunches on one day or the other. And all of those things were fine all year when we would do the checklist, but we would get lazy towards the end of the year. And we're like, oh, we don't need to look at this anymore. We know what we need. Well, clearly we didn't. So when your brain starts to tell you don't need structure and routine, it's lying, and tell that it's wrong and you're going to keep with the structure and the routine.
Wow. Well, you know, Christy, you know, I enjoy talking to you. I get excited. So how can listeners connect with you?
Yeah, absolutely. One of the best places, especially if you are a mom or entrepreneur with ADHD, is check out my YouTube channel. If you go to YouTube and search for the ADHD Mompreneur, you will find all sorts of content around just straight ADHD coping strategies, but then also like tips for being a mom with ADHD and sort of like mom hacks, and then also, you know, how to run a business and stay consistent and focused and not have 1,000 different shiny objects that you want to chase after when you're a business owner. And so I really wanted to kind of bring together all of those things about my life that I was passionate about. And so I have a YouTube channel that has, gosh, at this point, it's like almost 40 videos on it that are all related to those topics. And then you can also check me out on Facebook and Instagram at the ADHD Mompreneur.
And of course, you know, listeners, I will have all of the links so you can connect directly with Christy on the show page. Christy, thank you once again for your time.
And I enjoyed speaking with you. A 4-hour episode and it would go like that.
I know. It certainly would. I know it would. Thank you.